Although Britain was at war, there was very little sign of it in the fields and lanes of Kent, Surrey and Sussex during those early days of August, until the morning of Thursday, August the 8th. A decisive new phase had just begun in the Battle of Britain. During the past few weeks, the German Air Force, the Luftwaffe, had been concentrating their efforts on British shipping in the Channel, with sorties against the south and east coasts. From the 8th of August, the attacks took on a new intensity. During the previous night, a convoy of slow-moving merchant ships, escorted by our destroyers, had started through the Channel. But they were detected by the Germans, and early next morning, on the 8th of August, waves of Stukas with escorts attacked the ships. Seven squadrons of Hurricanes and Spitfires brought down 31 German planes for the loss of 19 of our own. Seven of our ships were lost and many more damaged. This was to be the pattern of attack in the Channel during the following days. Meantime in Berlin, plans for the invasion of Britain were being pursued. Hitler had hoped that with the fall of France, an isolated Britain might be glad to make a peace pact with him. When Churchill bluntly declined the offer, Hitler decided to invade at the earliest opportunity. The plan for Phase 1 was to knock out the Royal Air Force. Then he would have control of the air and sea lanes across the Channel. Next, they would carry out their blitzkrieg tactics. Then destroy all lines of communications and transport. Above all, get and retain complete command of the air. Phase 2 would begin with the destruction of the coastline defenses. Then the Luftwaffe could drop massive detachments of parachute troops to take over the airfields and establish beachheads. Phase 3, the actual invasion. Panzer divisions would cross in high-speed barges under a protective umbrella of Luftwaffe fighters. Then spearheads of landed troops would thrust into England to divide, surround, and destroy all opposition. And certainly there seemed to be very little opposition. In the whole of Britain, there was not enough equipment left for a single modern division, just one tank for every 1,000 square miles of territory, just one machine gun for each mile of beach. There was the British Navy, but it was scattered all over the globe, guarding vital food and supply routes. In any case, it would have been suicide to use the fleet in the narrow waters of the Channel with German forces flying overhead. There was the Royal Air Force, but it was outnumbered by the enemy 10-1, both in trained men and machines. There were the British people themselves. How would they react in the event of invasion? From the fall of France onwards, they had no doubt that there would be an attempt at invasion, and that it might come at any moment. They knew that every man, woman, and child in the country would be targeted, so they knew they had a big job to do, to successfully resist any invasion. For the civilian population, the home front, defense was the name of the game, to be ready for the onslaught whenever Hitler decided to unleash it. Back in Berlin, that was just what Hitler and his generals were discussing. The final touches were being put to the plans of Operation Sea Lion, Hitler's strategy for the invasion of Britain. The time had come for Phase 1 to begin. Goering sent in hundreds of aircraft of all types, bombers, fighters, dive bombers. Across that 21-mile stretch of channel, a mere 8 short minutes away. The first tactics were to bomb the convoys carrying food and munitions from overseas, bound for the ports of Bristol, Southampton, and London. German planes had already been carrying out a number of scattered raids during July. This was the first full concentrated attack, August the 8th. The next phase of the Battle of Britain had begun, in earnest. Goering had promised the Luftwaffe it would have little opposition from the RAF and would be able to knock it quickly out of the sky. However, there was a problem. The Royal Air Force of August 1940 was quite a different creature from the poorly equipped outfit which Hitler had known it to be at the time of Munich 2 years before. The days of August 1940 were absolutely critical for both Britain and Germany, if not in fact for the future of the free world. The skies over southern England were a daily battleground of fighter aircraft. It was a time of war, perhaps the last, when battles were being waged on almost a personal basis, by scarcely a handful of men rather than by armies of nameless troops. They kept the vastly superior Nazi forces at bay and gave us the breathing space we so desperately needed to bring our defenses up to scratch. Meantime, the German bombers continued pounding the coast from the Thames through Kent and Sussex to Weymouth and beyond. In just the first 10 days of this phase of the Battle of Britain, the Germans launched no less than 26 major attacks, during which time their aircraft losses totaled four times as many as ours. As many as 60 of the British pilots who bailed out were successfully rescued by our Air Sea Rescue Service. Most of the men picked up were trained and experienced pilots, fortunately able to fight again, unlike the German pilots we rescued. The Germans now turned their attention increasingly to port towns such as Southampton, Plymouth, and others, trying to immobilize the ports before the supplies from overseas grew from a trickle to a flood. Though the ports took a terrible onslaught, they couldn't be knocked out, and vital cargoes continued to be unloaded with the protection of the RAF above. It seemed that attacking the Hurricanes and Spitfires in the air just wasn't working. So Goering decided to smash them on the ground, at airfields such as Hawkinge, Manston, Tangmere, Biggin Hill. Names that were to become household words to the citizens of Britain. Many planes were saved by being parked in airfield corners, close to trees and hedges, instead of leaving them out on runways while awaiting the next sortie. The cost of the German attackers was high, and many trained pilots finished up as prisoners of war. It was a frustrating time for the Nazi leaders. On a 2,000-mile front from Norway to Normandy, the Blitz program was being stymied because the RAF was still flying. Hitler sent for Field Marshal Goering and ordered him to bring British resistance to a quick end. It was seriously holding up his plans for invasion before mid-September and the end of summer. So Goering ordered all-out attacks, not only on airfields further inland, but on factories, machine shops, and anything supplying the aircraft industry. If he couldn't knock out the RAF in the air, he hoped to knock it out by starvation on the assembly line. He adopted the tactics of using proportionally more fighters per bomber so that the bombers were well protected for doing their job, escorted by their fighters all around them. They were able to break through our coastal defense by sheer weight of numbers and reached further inland than they had so far managed. Bombing aerodromes, aircraft plants, munitions factories, and machine shops. The people's morale was at a remarkable level. Their defense system was improving rapidly. Improved observation and listening posts were set up all along the coast, in addition to radar, which all contributed to detecting enemy approach activity before he even left the continent. A quick flash from control station to the nearest fighter station, and British pilots were on their way to greet the enemy before he reached the shores of Britain, while still over the channel. Day after day, aerial battles were being fought out in the skies 4 or 5 miles above the countryside of Kent and Sussex, sometimes out of sight and often out of sound of spotters below. The pilots kept flying, barely snatching a couple of hours' rest before scrambling to another sortie. This sometimes continued for days on end. As far as the Nazi leaders were concerned, their plans for invasion were going nowhere fast. Already, Hitler had to postpone the proposed date of Operation Sea Lion, his plan for the invasion and occupation of Britain. The time had come to employ a different tactic. From now on, the objective was plain and simple. It was to crush and devastate the spirit and morale of the people, to make it impossible for them to continue the war against the Nazis any longer. It began on the afternoon of Saturday, September the 7th. The siren sound that Londoners had heard in daylight from time to time during August was now to become part of the daily and nightly life of every child, woman, and man in the capital for more than 100 consecutive nights, along with the drone of enemy bombers, anti-aircraft fire, and the whistle and crunch of high explosive bombs dropped in their thousands. For the Luftwaffe, there was no pretense of striking only military targets. To their surprise, and the surprise of neutral nations, sometimes to the surprise of Londoners themselves, they steeled themselves to it. Throughout the following week, Goering sent fleets of bombers to smash the spirit of the citizens, but without success. Goering now decided to throw in the full might of his Luftwaffe in one of the greatest air attacks ever mounted till then. It was a Sunday. The date? September the 15th, 1940, a day to become one of the most famous dates in the Battle of Britain. It was an ideal summer day when his fleet of 500 bombers and fighters flew over the channel and crossed the English coast.
For hostile planes approaching from the southwest.
Londoners taking a Sunday stroll were unaware that an historic three-dimensional battle was being fought to the death in the skies above them throughout the day, in a front 60 miles long, 40 wide, and 5 to 6 miles in height. Hour alone, 200 individual combats had taken place. Some German planes pierced the London defences. Some reached the sky above the city centre. It wasn't until most people had returned home that evening and listened to their wireless sets that they learned about the most decisive air battle of the war. The first reports gave an overestimate of the German aircraft shot down. It wasn't until much later that the figure was revised downwards. Nevertheless, it was a mortal blow to the Luftwaffe and Hitler's plans for invading Britain on the 17th of September, just 2 days later. From that time on, the invasion was postponed indefinitely. The Nazi military policy now was the destruction of the capital, mostly at night. The RAF couldn't be much help at night. It all rested on the efficiency of searchlights and the accuracy of anti-air fire. The German bombers at first concentrated particularly on London's Dockland and left the East End districts a roaring inferno. But some things gave them hope. British bombers were taking the Blitz back into its country of origin. Hitler proclaimed the RAF as night gangsters, and for their crime, he would exact on British cities a thousandfold revenge. The first target was to be the city of Coventry. On the night of the 14th of November, £1 million of bombs were hurled on the city. Between dusk that night and the following dawn, it was bombed flatter and more heavily than Rotterdam or Warsaw. The almost total destruction of Coventry and other cities such as Plymouth brought the war not a second nearer to its end for the Germans. For 109 consecutive nights, one part of London or another was savagely bombed. But unexpectedly, one night, the citizens had their first night off, December the 25th, 1940. It was an unbelievable break, but only a break. It all began again. But in the days to come, the citizens became aware that the raids were becoming shorter and fewer, so that by the spring they were hardly there at all. Almost out of the blue, the Blitz returned with doubled fury. For many people, it seemed worse than anything that had gone before, as millions of firebombs rained down on the capital. In a matter of minutes, more than 1,500 different sections of the city burst into roaring flames. Flames that merged together into what was the greatest fire since the Great Fire of London almost 300 years before. Below ground, in the tube stations and shelters, the people of London felt they were back where they had been 4 months ago. It seemed that they were to have to endure it all over again. But next day, to everyone's amazement, there was no siren. They didn't know it then, but Hitler had turned away from Britain to undertake the conquest of Russia. The Battle of Britain had been finally won, but not by Hitler. He had lost 2,375 planes and crew. For the first time, the Germans had tasted defeat. For almost a year, they had struck Britain with their formidable might. They had killed over 40,000 British people and seriously wounded 50,000 or more. But from the start, not one single Nazi soldier set foot as an invader upon the soil of mainland Britain. The Battle of Britain and the people who won it also won for the world a year of precious time in which to prepare for final victory.
On the 20th of May 1942,
Allied listening stations around the Pacific picked up a lengthy radio signal in code from Admiral Yamamoto to his fleet. It was revealed that the Japanese Navy was about to mount a powerful attack on the mid-Pacific atoll of Midway with a secondary diversionary attack on the Aleutians further north. Dutch harbour in the Aleutians would be hit on the 3rd of June and Midway the next day. Yamamoto committed almost the entire Japanese fleet to his plan. 160 warships, including 8 aircraft carriers, with more than 400 carrier-based aircraft. Knowing that the odds were stacked heavily against him, Nimitz staked everything on his faith in the aircraft carrier and its ability to strike from long range. Nimitz divided his force into two battle groups. Task Force 16 with the carriers U.S. Hornet and Enterprise, and Task Force 17 with the carrier Yorktown. Warned by intelligence, they were in position well before the Japanese submarines had established a cordon west of Hawaii to watch for the United States fleet. The Midway garrison had been reinforced, and during the previous night, flying fortresses had landed at Midway. By 0700 hours, they were on the runway being refueled. Once the enemy had been sighted, they would be in place and ready to mount an air raid attack on the fleet. On dawn patrol, Ensign Jack Reed, flying a Catalina flying boat from Midway, was scouring the skies looking for signs of the enemy fleet. At 0900 hours, he spotted the transport ships and escort cruisers of the Japanese invasion force. He ordered an attack to be mounted by the Midway-based B-17 flying fortresses. As the bombers lumbered down the airstrip, news came in to Fletcher that the Japanese diversionary attack was already underway. In the early hours of the morning, the Japanese had attacked the Aleutian Islands. Torpedo bombers and Zero fighters from the carrier Ryujo attacked the United States base at Dutch Harbor on Unalaska Island. They inflicted damage on the oil dumps, barracks, hospital, and a church. Meanwhile, Nimitz, not deceived by this diversion, refused to divert large forces north away from Midway. The 4th of June, and the United States fleet's main prey, the Japanese carrier striking force, under Admiral Nagumo, was zigzagging through dense fog, completely oblivious of Fletcher's fleet lying in wait for them. In the early hours of the morning, they reached calm and clear conditions. At 0430 hours, Nagumo launched his first strike. 108 aircraft took off from the carriers to attack Midway. They were immediately spotted on Midway's radar. The Zero fighters appeared from behind the clouds and the island's defenses went into action immediately. Midway's fighters went up to engage the enemy. Considerable damage was inflicted on the airfield buildings and garrison, but the airstrip remained intact. Gumo was now in a quandary. His first attack had not knocked out the airfield as planned. It was still operational. A second air attack was needed. Before he had made a decision, however, the Americans made up his mind for him. The bombers from Midway had arrived overhead and were attacking his ships. Although they did no damage, they did change the course of the battle. The Japanese commander ordered his second wave torpedo bombers to be rearmed with bombs for another attack on Midway. At 0728 hours, 15 minutes after the commander had ordered his aircraft below, one of Nagumo's search planes spotted 10 United States warships some 335 kilometers northeast of the Japanese carriers. Ironically, this plane had taken off 30 minutes late that morning. Had it taken off on time, it would have spotted the Americans 30 minutes earlier and got the news back before the torpedo bombers had been sent below. If this had been the case, Nagumo would almost have certainly sent his aircraft against the United States fleet, and the course of the battle and of the entire war in the Pacific might have been very different. As it was, Nagumo was yet again in a quandary. Should he turn his attention to the United States ships or concentrate on Midway? Also unbeknown to Nagumo, Fletcher had launched his aircraft and was about to attack at any moment. Fletcher had ordered the Hornet and the Enterprise ahead to attack, while the Yorktown waited to retrieve the spotter planes. At 0700 hours, the Hornet and Enterprise, still a long way off from the Japanese carriers, launched their aircraft, 152 of them. They were aware that the Japanese were landing aircraft after the attack on Midway, that they were taking a big gamble, launching from such a dangerous long range. However, what these pilots didn't know was that Nagumo had changed course when he decided to reload his aircraft. As a result, the first aircraft had difficulty locating their prey. At 0928 hours, the first United States torpedo planes from the Hornet appeared over the Japanese fleet, diving into attack. The Japanese launched their Zeros, attempting to drive the bombers away from the ships, and there was a fierce and bloody fight in the skies. By 0945 hours, another wave of torpedo bombers arrived from the Enterprise, followed by another wave from the Yorktown at 10:15. The American losses were high. The Zeros and anti-aircraft fire from the ships were taking their toll. Only four out of the Enterprise's first wave made it back to the carrier. The Hornet and Yorktown crews suffered equally. Those that did make it back had the problems of landing a battle-damaged aircraft on a rolling carrier deck. Lieutenant Commander McCluskey scanned the sparkling blue Pacific northeast of Midway Island. He was leading 33 dive bombers from the Enterprise and was lost. He needed to make a decision. Where he had expected to find the enemy, there was nothing, and his planes would soon have to turn back for lack of fuel. But McCluskey had a hunch. He decided to continue his search a little further west, and the gamble paid off. Nimitz later described this as the most important decision of the battle. A few minutes later, McCluskey spotted the wake of an enemy destroyer and followed it. Just after 1000 hours, he found the Japanese carriers. The first waves of bombers which had attacked previously had suffered disastrously. Most of them had been shot down by the Zeros. But this first attack had let McCluskey's dive bombers come in unnoticed. Joined by a further 17 dive bombers from the Yorktown, McCluskey could not have arrived at a better moment. The decks of the Japanese carriers were crammed with nearly 100 aircraft as they prepared for their own strike against the United States carriers. As the Japanese carriers were turning into the wind to launch their aircraft, 50 United States dive bombers were hurtling in from the sky. The first hits turned the carriers Akagi, Kaga, and Soryu into exploding torches. Within minutes, most of the Japanese first air fleet had been wiped out. The fourth carrier, Hiryu, was saved and tried a desperate counterattack. At 1200 hours, she launched her aircraft against the Yorktown. During this stage of the battle, despite desperate maneuvering, the Yorktown took several direct hits.
The Yorktown fought hard for survival against the Japanese bombers, but it was in vain. By 1440 hours, following another direct hit from a torpedo, the Yorktown was so badly crippled that Fletcher had no other alternative than to abandon her. He handed command over to Admiral Spruance, commander of Task Force 16. At 1700 hours, Spruance launched his aircraft from the Hornet and Enterprise. Their mission? To attack the Hiryu. Direct hits set her decks ablaze. The Hiryu was crippled beyond repair. During the night of the 4th of June, whilst the United States crews on board Hornet and Enterprise prepared their aircraft for the next day's battle, the Japanese carriers Soryu and Kaga sank to the bottom of the ocean. As dawn broke on the morning of the 5th of June, news came back to the United States fleet that the Hiryu, still burning like a torch, was sinking fast. Shortly afterwards, reports came back that the remaining Japanese carrier, Akagi, had followed the same fate as the other three. Four of Japan's finest carriers had gone. On the 6th of June, Yamamoto gave the order for a general withdrawal, but not before United States planes attacked two of the Japanese cruisers, sinking one of them and badly damaging the other. On the morning of the 7th of June, damage control crews boarded the Yorktown in an effort to save her. However, a short while later she was torpedoed by a Japanese submarine and was sent to the bottom. Whilst both sides claimed the previous battle in the Coral Sea a victory, there could be no doubt about Midway. The United States had destroyed the Japanese main striking force of four carriers and a heavy cruiser, 322 aircraft, and almost 5,000 men and officers. The United States Pacific Fleet, far from being destroyed as Yamamoto had promised, had won a remarkable victory. And what's more, as often happens in military history, they won a victory against an enemy far superior in terms of numbers. Whilst the Japanese effort was compromised by poor strategy, tactical error, and misfortune, the Americans were aided by excellent intelligence, naval air organization, tactical command, and most important of all, a great deal of luck. Despite the loss of one carrier, 137 aircraft and 307 men, the Americans had turned the tide of the war in the Pacific. No longer would Japan be in a position to risk a major fleet versus fleet action, and were now on the defensive.
In September 1939, Bomber Command had only 53 squadrons. Of these, only 33 were considered fully operational, and 10 of these were immediately dispatched to France to accompany the British Expeditionary Force. The squadron's aircraft were Blenheims, Hamptons, Wellingtons, Whitleys, and Fairy Battles. All of them at least 6 years old in concept. With little more than 300 first-line bombers based in Britain, Bomber Command was clearly incapable of pursuing any true bombing offensive against Germany. Therefore, throughout the winter months of 1939-40, RAF bombers were dispatched in tiny formations on what were termed armed reconnaissance sorties. Maintaining the tight formations advocated by the bomber hierarchy, the young crews were quickly disillusioned about their defensive capabilities. The disastrous results of these revealed the inadequacy of the unescorted bomber theory and forced the RAF to restrict its bombing to night raids in future. On the 16th and 17th of December, in possibly their last significant raid of 1940, RAF Bomber Command marked a new departure. The aiming point for the 134 aircraft was not any industrial area or individual building, but the very center of the town of Mannheim. This was a reprisal raid in retaliation for the bombing of Coventry and other British towns. This was the largest number of British bombers to date sent to a single target and was the first purely urban attack. The first 14 Wellingtons were sent in with incendiary bombs to set the town alight and mark the target, whilst the rest of the bomber force followed the glare of the flames. At a cost of only 3 aircraft lost and 4 more which crashed on return, the force destroyed 476 buildings, killed 47 people, and made a further 1,266 homeless. 1941 opened for Bomber Command with a raid on the very first day of the year. More than 100 aircraft took off to bomb the Fokker Wolf aircraft factory and other industrial targets in the city of Bremen. The raid was a success, and the losses to the RAF were slight. In fact, the year began with a new directive, which was a continuation of the one that had been issued at the end of 1940. Oil was the primary target. However, the poor weather conditions of that winter were still hampering operations. In March, things were to change once again. Another diversion arose, which was to take bombing away from those primary oil targets. For the following 4 months, the priority was to defeat Germany's attempt to cut off Britain's food supplies, and subsequently, her connection with the United States. By mid-March, 17 new squadrons had been added to the force, and even more important, the first of the new type of heavy bombers were trickling into service. By early 1941, the high-capacity, or HC bomb, had made its debut when, on March the 31st, 2 4,000-pound HC bombs were dropped on Emden by specially modified Wellingtons. These new weapons were complemented by an increasing variety of incendiary bombs, often with explosive charges, which would scatter the burning content over a wide area. The Admiralty, absorbed almost entirely in its campaign against the German submarines threatening Britain's lifelines of merchant shipping, pleaded strongly for bomber squadrons to continue to be employed against the U-boat bases and especially the German capital ships, Scharnhorst and Gneisenau and Prince Eugen based at Brest. Apart from one last big raid on Gelsenkirchen on the 14th and 15th of March, attacks on German oil dwindled away. In the next 3 months, 28 attacks with an average strength of around 100 aircraft were aimed at one or other of the 3 main ports, Hamburg, Kiel, and Bremen. Hamburg was amongst the least difficult targets to find in Germany, and the damage inflicted was therefore considerable. The raids caused over 500 fires and made some 3,700 people homeless. And twice, the Blohm & Voss U-boat yards were hit again with considerable accuracy. The raid on Bremen on the 27th and 28th of June found a disturbing new development in the enemy's defenses. German night fighters were now operating in large numbers. The result of this was to cause the highest number of bombers lost in a night raid so far, 14 aircraft out of the force of 108. By July, the air staff was free to return to a strategic bombing campaign. It was clear that the earlier campaign against oil installations had caused little damage and no major effect on production. In a directive issued on the 9th of July 1941, Bomber Command was ordered to dislocate the German transportation system. This would have the effect of isolating the region and prevent any movement of war materials to the front. If the weather over Western Germany as a whole was poor, then the more distant targets of Frankfurt, Mannheim, and Stuttgart should be bombed. In November, 105 Squadron received its first example of the revolutionary de Havilland Mosquito all-wood bomber, the harbinger of a host of Mosquito bomber versions, which were to become a major factor in the strategic bombing offensive against Germany. A momentous turning point for Bomber Command came on February the 20th, 1942, when a new commander took up his appointment. Air Marshal Arthur Harris. Only 6 days previously, a directive emanating from the Air Staff and sanctioned by the War Cabinet ordered Bomber Command to commence a prolonged area bombing, whereby large targets, such as industrial towns and cities, were to become primary targets for night bombing. On the 8th and 9th of March, and for the following 2 nights, G-led bombers hit the town of Essen. G proved itself as an excellent navigational aid, but they did find it was not precise enough for the blind bombing of targets. On the 13th and 14th of March, after a raid on Kiel, Harris turned to another of his four major targets, the city of Cologne. Cologne was hit by 135 aircraft, which managed to start 237 fires and destroy several factories, and damage over 1,500 houses. Essen, however, still remained the number one target. And over the next 2 weeks, Harris made five more attempts to hit it. On the night of 30th and 31st of May 1942, a total of 1,046 bombers took off in two waves from airfields throughout the east of England, destined for Cologne. They were preceded by 88 aircraft on intruder and diversionary sorties to confuse the German defenses. Never before had the German night fighters been offered such a golden opportunity, but no fighters came. Hitler, against the advice of his commanders, had made another of his costly mistakes. He had forbidden the Luftwaffe to attack the RAF over British soil. Had he not given this order, this raid could not only have been the first 1,000 bomber raid, but also the last, and possibly the costliest raid ever for Bomber Command. At 23:14 hours, the first of the bombers were spotted on German radar. As the bombers passed over the Dutch coast, there was surprisingly little resistance from the night fighters, although there was considerable flak. At 45 minutes past midnight, the first of the stream approached the target. The bombers soon converged on the target, the center of the city. They came in and bombed at a rate of one aircraft every 6 seconds. Incendiaries crashed downwards, splashing brilliant white as they hit the ground, and then turning red as the timber caught fire. House after house, building after building began to burn. The huge rubber works was hit, and then the railway station. For the bombers still coming in, the red glare was like daylight. The people of Cologne were now finding a bitter meaning in the propaganda minister Dr. Goebbels' words. "We're all in the front line now." 90 minutes later, it was all over. 13,000 homes had been destroyed. 45,000 people were now homeless. 1,500 factories were obliterated beyond repair, and 630 more seriously damaged. Harris had achieved his prime objectives and received approval for future massive expansion of the force. And this marked a turning point for Bomber Command. In August 1942, a new formation of huge significance came into being when the Pathfinder Force was inaugurated. Its purpose was succinct: to spearhead main bombing sorties and locate and mark the target accurately before the main bomber stream arrived. Another significant moment came in December when Mosquitoes used OBO, the revolutionary new navigational aid, for the first time on an operation. It was December the 20th when they set out to bomb the coal plant at Lutterande in eastern Holland. Bomber Command now had a long-awaited blind bombing system. As 1942 drew to a close, Harris now had a force that was now much stronger. Cologne had proved that accuracy in hitting the target had increased by 30%. The final proof of the success of OBO was confirmed on the first night of 1943. Two OBO-fitted Mosquitoes, bombing from 28,000 feet and through thick cloud, hit the German night fighter headquarters near Florennes in Belgium. Lancasters, led by Pathfinders, found and attacked with some success Dusseldorf, Duisburg, and Essen. A total of 43 major raids were mounted between March and June 1943. The last blows of the Ruhr at this time were on the 25th and 26th of July, when Harris sent 705 aircraft to bomb Essen. And a final one on the 30th and 31st of July, a force of 273 aircraft hit the town of Remscheid, a Ruhr town not previously attacked. 4/5 of the built-up area of the town was destroyed, and over 100 factories and commercial buildings were put out of action. On the night of May the 16th and 17th, 1943, 19 specially modified Lancasters of the recently formed 617 Squadron attacked the Mona, Eder, and the Sorpe dams. Using precise attack methods and specially constructed explosive canisters, they shattered the dams at Mona and Eder and damaged the Sorpe. By the summer of 1943, Bomber Command had been joined in its offensives by the B-17s and B-24s of the USAAF's 8th Air Force, whose concentration on daylight sorties initially forced them to suffer a high casualty rate. These heavy daylight raids complemented Harris's nightly onslaught. This combined bomber offensive was authorized by a fresh directive from the Combined Chiefs of Staff, named Point Blank, dated June the 10th, 1943. Expressing concern at the mounting casualties caused by the enlarging and increasingly efficient Luftwaffe fighter defenses, Point Blank called for a switch in concentration of bombing to targets directly related to these fighters and their supporting industry. As the second most important city of Germany, Hamburg offered great possibilities as a target for area destruction. In 1943, Hamburg was the largest port in Europe and Germany's second largest city, with a population of around 1 million. On the night of July 24th, 25th, 791 bombers took off on their grim task of destruction. 80 miles from the German coast, H2S Pathfinders put down yellow route markers. For the first time, the crews dropped their loads of inoffensive-looking bundles of metallized paper strips, codename Window, which had been designed to paralyze the German radar. All but 63 of the 791 aircraft dropped 2,277 tons of high explosive and incendiary bombs into the built-up areas of the city and port. But this wasn't the end. For the fires that had started with the incendiary devices whipped up into a blazing inferno. Hamburg was the world's first city to experience a firestorm. The weather had been very hot and dry, which caused the timber to burn easily. The fire spread and soon became one huge bonfire. The rising heat was so intense, it created a violent upcurrent and consequently sucked in fresh air at ground level, reaching gale force, even hurricane force speeds. On the night of the 27th and 28th, Bomber Command struck again. Nearly 800 bombers attacked, and 729 of them released a further 2,417 tons of bombs. The massive firestorm continued. Two further raids completed the fearful destruction of the ancient city. The Battle of Hamburg was one of the most concentrated and successful series of operations undertaken by Bomber Command. In terms of destruction, the results were unprecedented. Harris's next objective was Berlin, the big city, as it was termed by the bomber crews. Beginning on November the 18th and 19th, 1943, a total of 16 major raids were sent against the German capital. These raids devastated over 2,000 acres of Berlin, killed nearly 6,000 inhabitants, and rendered 1.5 million Germans homeless. The cost to Bomber Command was not light. 492 bombers and their crews were missing. The point-blank plan, which had begun in early 1943, culminated in late February 1944, when for 6 days and nights, starting on February the 23rd, Bomber Command and the U.S. 8th Air Force combined in the big week to drop 16,506 tons of bombs on Germany. In preparation for Operation Overlord, a new directive came for Bomber Command. This was known as the Transportation Plan. Knowing how dependent the German armies were on the railways, this was a plan for a major assault on the rail transport systems, which, it was hoped, would create a railway void between Western Germany and the French coast. This task would be split between Bomber Command and the 8th Air Force. In all, from the opening assault on Trapp until the final D-Day blow against the same target on the 2nd and 3rd of June, Bomber Command put in 69 such attacks. The damage caused was enormous. From Cologne and Aachen, through Ghent and Courtrai, to the centers around Paris and as far afield as Le Mans and Orleans, the railways became scenes of desolation. By late August 1944, with the Allied armies flooding across Europe towards Germany, Chief of the Air Staff requested that Bomber Command be released from Eisenhower's direct control in order to recommence the purely strategic bombing offensive. Priority targets were now defined as Germany's oil refineries and the remaining war industries. The German transportation system and tank and truck production plants were given second priority. The German war machine was being brought to a standstill. In the autumn of 1944, Bomber Command also continued, as it had done so before, with its highly productive mine-laying operations. But the command's maritime operations went far beyond this. They attacked U-boat pens and also hit the coastal towns of Königsberg, Stettin, Bremen, Emden, Kiel, and Wilhelmshaven. By early 1945, German oil and fuel production had already diminished to a relative trickle, starving the aircraft, tanks, and other transports still desperately fighting on all fronts. Harris continued to adhere to his personal creed of area bombing of large conglomerate objectives. Furthermore, the successful Russian offensive, which had begun in mid-January of the same year, had created a new military situation. As the Russians advanced through Silesia, it became apparent that air attacks on the East German cities, which confronted them, might be of powerful assistance to the Soviet drive. At the Allied conference at Yalta, the Russians requested the Allied cooperation in the mass bombing of all communications in Germany to prevent any reinforcement of the German Eastern Front. They wanted these attacks within an agreed bomb line to keep the British and American air forces away from any territory they might soon occupy. Following a few days of bad weather, on the 13th of February, Bomber Command was ready for the assault on the unsuspecting German city. After a 10-hour flight, the first wave of bombers approached Dresden. The city below was ill-prepared for its fate. The resulting fires could be seen from a distance of 80 kilometers away. It was a scene of devastation. The city had gone. In its place was a pile of rubble and burning buildings. Rescue workers fought to free trapped survivors in the shelters below. The firefighting crews couldn't cope with the overwhelming amount of burning buildings. This once proud and beautiful city was now thick with flames and smoke. Many people had died in the shelters under the crushing weight of the fallen masonry. Many more were trapped, but the rescue workers couldn't reach all of them in time to save them, and hundreds of people perished from asphyxiation. More people died in Dresden than in Hiroshima or Nagasaki. From the very first hours of the war until the final flights above a totally ruined Nazi Germany, the men of Bomber Command had never flinched from their given tasks. Returning night after night in the deadly skies over Europe,